Shall we start with basic ideas, definitions? Okay, I have called it basic ideas and definitions for the simple reason that thermodynamics, fortunately or unfortunately, uses a number of terms which are common to not only thermodynamics but to many other subjects. Thermodynamics is a part of science and part of engineering, so does not divorce from other branches of science and engineering, and soon we will see that thermodynamics works with those branches of science and engineering. So in fluid mechanics we talk of pressure, velocity, we use those ideas in thermodynamics, but there are many ideas which are common to thermodynamics, many terminologies which are used by thermodynamics and also by other sciences, which have slightly different meanings. For example, we talk about he is running a temperature when somebody is feverish. So, in a household language, temperature runs. In thermodynamics, temperature is a property, it simply exists, it can be measured but it cannot run. Okay. The school kiddish question, which moves faster, heat or cold? And the answer from a school kid's point of view is heat, because you can catch a cold, you can't catch heat. Okay. So ideas of temperature, particularly the idea of work. The work interaction or work which we talk of thermodynamics, and it is one of the first topics which is discussed, is common between thermodynamics, fluid mechanics, many branches of physics. There is mechanical work, there is electrical work, in chemistry there is chemical work, electrochemical work, photochemical work and all that. So the ideas of work there and ideas of work in thermodynamics, are they the same? They may not be. But we need to be very precise in our definition of work. Similarly, some ideas from other branches of science we will simply adopt, saying this is the idea, this is the definition, these are the characteristics or properties of that idea, we will use it. So it is necessary for students to say that look, we will redefine everything, whatever you have learnt is true but may not be the whole truth, may not be nothing but the truth. Okay. So we will straighten that out, so ask them to be patient. And then we first come to these things, primitives, premises and derivations. So we should be clear about these ideas. What are primitives? What is a primitive? How many of you are interested in or enjoyed school geometry, Euclidean geometry? Nobody. Only one hand, two hands. I still enjoy. You know, after every March, April, I look at the 10th standard, 12th standard books. The geometry problems are the most enjoyable. Now, all of you know, or those who are take interest in Euclidean geometry know that Euclidean geometry is based on Euclid's five postulates. Okay. Those postulates are something which are to be true. Those are the primitives. The idea of a point is not defined in geometry, it is a primitive. We know what its characteristics are. It has a position but it has no extent otherwise except a position. So something, an idea which is inherited is a primitive. So in thermodynamics, ideas concepts definitions from other branches of science, engineering. These are known as primitives. we will adopt them as they are. For example, all ideas from mechanics. So, volume, stress, position, these are primitives. So, example, it is good always whenever you talk of something, to one or two sentences of thermodynamic talk, possibly followed by an example. Keep them always illustrated with illustrations. For example, you take a position, displacement, from mechanics. You can take volume from geometry. You take pressure velocity from fluid mechanics. You take mass force from mechanics. The list is endless. You take charge current from electricity, magnetism, magnetic induction, magnetic flux from magnetism. Okay. Thermodynamics does not isolate itself from any other branch of physics. If there is a good idea, has something to do with energy, directly or indirectly, we will use it in thermodynamics. That is a primitive. Primitive means we will not tell much about it. Velocity, talk to a mechanics person or a fluid mechanics person. The ideas which are useful there are simply adopted here. So, everything from geometry, everything from electricity, magnetism, everything from mechanics is adopted in thermodynamics, and all those ideas are primitives. Okay. We build on them. So, somebody asks you to define pressure in thermodynamics, we say nothing. Whatever you have learnt in fluid dynamics as pressure is applicable in thermodynamics for pressure. Now, for example, non-primitives. Non-primitives are proper thermodynamic entities which we will formally define in thermodynamics. And if you really go to the bottom of it, there are only two things which we will define very formally and very properly in thermodynamics. No other branch of science has any claim on these two properties. And these two properties are the temperature T and the entropy S. I am sure you will immediately take objection, a few of you, and before you raise your hand, how many of you now want me to ask this question? What about energy? What about work? I have not talked of them as primitives. I have not talked of them as basic thermodynamic entities. Where do they lie? They are derived? No. Energy, we had energy, we have potential energy, kinetic energy, fluid kinetic energy and all that in fluid dynamics and mechanics. We have work in mechanics, we have work in fluid dynamics, we have charge moving to a potential difference, we have work in electromagnetics. They are neither premises nor purely thermodynamics. Work and energy are special in the sense that they have some characteristics of premises, but we will put them on proper thermodynamic basis. because even before thermodynamics, ideas of work existed, idea of energy existed. Okay. These two are on the borderline of thermodynamics and other branches of physics. If they were not there, thermodynamics would have been an isolated science. It is not an isolated science. We will adopt definitions of work, but we will have a proper definition of work in thermodynamics, which is slightly different, but very proper, consistent definition of work in thermodynamics. And hence, quite a few authors and quite a few people tend to call our work as thermodynamic work. When we come to the definition, we will realize the way work is defined in mechanics and work is defined in thermodynamics. Work is defined in mechanics as force into displacement, FDS, okay? Whereas work is defined in thermodynamics as an interaction. Two systems must be involved. We link it with some energy interaction, okay? Two systems will involve. Similarly, in thermodynamics, we claim that we define the global energy or the total thermodynamic energy E. And then we find that other branches of physics have already defined their components of energy. So we say, okay, this energy will have all those components. So long as we don't do anything inconsistent, we are on firm ground. So remember that primitives are something which are purely defined and adopted by thermodynamics, defined in other branches of science and adopted in thermodynamics. Thermodynamic entities are those which are very properly defined in thermodynamics and only in thermodynamics. And there are only two basic thermodynamic entities, temperature and entropy. And there are two special entities, the work interaction and energy, which are persona grata in thermodynamics as well as other branches of physics. So we will redefine work in a rather restrictive way. So because of that, what will happen is some situation where a physicist will say so much work is done, we will say where is the work interaction? But something which is work in thermodynamics is definitely work in physics. So we will have a restrictive thermodynamic definition of work. Similarly, energy. Our energy definition will be a superset of all other energy definitions. And it is, we claim it to be a superset because we have not come across any illustration or example of that being a superset. Any other branches have an energy that becomes just a component of this energy. And from that way, thermodynamics turns out to be an overriding science. Doesn't go into detail. Just takes care of the energy interactions. So, this is about primitives and non-primitives. Now, what are premises? What is a premise? It is another word for an assumption, isn't it? If you look up a dictionary, you will find a premise is something which is assumed to be true. And why don't we call it an assumption? Just because premise is a rather uncommon word, assumption is something which is a common. A premise in thermodynamics is something which is demonstrated to be a true characteristic of nature. For example, Einstein's fifth postulates, like about the parallel lines, is a premise. Okay. The postulates of say about angles, about a straight line. For example, one of the postulates of Euclid is that between on a plane geometry. If you have 2 points, you can draw one straight line and only one straight line between those 2 points. That is a premise. There is no proof in Euclidean geometry for it. But we know it is true from our experience. On a plane surface, we have never been able to find 2 points through which we can draw 2 independent distinct straight lines. Okay? So there are a certain number of ideas which we know as premises in thermodynamics. So some of these you already know. Which are those? Laws of thermodynamics, are they premises? There is no proof. They are assumed to be true and they are demonstrated. They are not really demonstrated, they are never derived. We only have faith in them because we have not come across any contradictory situation. Somebody says, demonstrate the first law of thermodynamics. I say, demonstrate anything. I am moving from here to here. That is first law of thermodynamics. Anything happens has to be consistent with the first law of thermodynamics. Okay, it is not like demonstrate the boiling of water or demonstrate that salt to some extent is soluble in water. We have not come across any situation which seems to violate those premises. So how many premises do we have? We are going to remain in the domain of classical thermodynamics. So zeroth law, first law, second law. But are they sufficient? Apparently not, because it turns out that there are certain additional premises which are known as state postulates. We will come to those. Those are also premises in thermodynamics. They, for some reason, and I do not know why, they have never been given the status of a law of thermodynamics. But without them, we cannot proceed in thermodynamics. And those generally go by the name state postulates. And there is one of them which is demonstrated to be a proper premise. The other one, under certain assumptions of differentiability, can be derived. We will come to that. So premises are laws, and premises are always true. Again, remember that something which is a premise in one branch of science may not be a premise in some other branch of science. Okay? We are going to restrict ourselves to the classical thermodynamics. So one of the premises of ours will be that all the entities that we come across, pressure, temperature, volume, energy, entropy, anything, all our systems are continuous systems. They are continua, and all these properties and all these interactions, anything which we are going to talk about, are continuous variables. There is no quantization. That is one of our premises in classical thermodynamics. But this will not remain a premise when you go to molecular or statistical thermodynamics. Okay? So remember that one branch of science will consider something to be a premise. That premise may not remain a premise when you come to some other even related branch of science. This happens not only in physics, it happens even in geometry. For example, you have Euclidean geometry, remove the fixed postulate, you have a whole set of non-Euclidean geometries. Okay. So something which is a premise here will not be a premise there. So premises are laws which will always be true. We will not derive them, but we will have faith in them because there are no contradictions involved. And beyond that, there are only derivations, and definitions. For example, the second law of thermodynamics, we will be using the Kelvin-Planck statement as the basic statement. That will be our premise. But then the Carnot theorem will be a derivation. Okay? The Clausius inequality will be a derivation. The Clausius statement of the second law of thermodynamics will be a derivation. So, we will use something as a premise, everything else will be derivation. It is possible. For example, and many textbooks show that a second law, a primary statement of the second law can either be the Kelvin-Planck statement or the Clausius statement. Okay. When we come to that, we will decide to select one of them as a premise. Why not the other? That we will come at that time. But it is in principle possible to accept Clausius statement as the premise and derive Kelvin-Planck from it. We will soon come to premises. Let us go in the order in which we have. Maybe I should keep this here so that I can flip back and forth. So, premises, primitives, premises, derivations are all the derivations which come after our premises. So, first law open system will be a derivation. Similarly, in fact, even definition of entropy, Clausius inequality will be a derivation because it is neither a primitive nor a premise. Now, we are going to lay out our framework by some suitable definitions. And when it comes to definitions, we are going to have essentially two types of definitions. The first type of definition we are going to use is short forms. For example, one of the famous short forms we will be using is H is U plus B. And when it comes to a short form definition, I usually have a habit of showing with a triple lined equal to, meaning this is nothing but this. Anytime you see the left hand side, you can replace it by right hand side or the right hand side by the left hand side, vice versa. Okay. So, this could be a symbolic short form like this, or it could be a verbal short form which we will soon come. A large bundle of words will be reduced to two or three words. For example, the first law is a short form for a very big statement which we expect the students to know as the statement of the first law. The second type of definition, and which is going to be important for us, is going to be what is known as operational definition. Now, the question is, what is operational definition? The idea of operational definition was first proposed and expanded on by Paul Bridgman. The operational definition says something about the identity or the entity to be defined by providing a procedure or a sequence of operations for deciding whether that entity is something is true or false, or how to measure it. So, operational definition of energy of a system would be a procedure as to how to measure the energy of a system. Operational definition of an open system would be a set of procedures to decide whether a system is open or not. Okay. So this is a set of operations, that means a procedure to decide is yes or no, for example, open system. Or it can be for major or quantify an entity. And we will come across these operational definitions throughout our course on thermodynamics. Everything which is measured, unless it is a primitive, in which case the other branch of science will tell us how to measure it. Even there, operational definitions can be used. But in thermodynamics, we will be using operational definitions because of the strength of those definitions. You have a procedure which anybody can follow, or anybody interested enough and studious enough will be able to follow and decide whether that thing exists or not. No question of whether a system is an open system or not, whether a process is reversible or not. Such things, or in case of such things as temperature, energy, entropy, things which we are going to define in thermodynamics, it tells us a procedure by which these things are to be measured. And one important thing for us is we are going to have no circular definition. What is a circular definition? There is a book by one of the great people in computer science known as Donald Knuth. He has a some book, I think it is, he has a set of books known as The Art of Computer Programming. Go to the first volume. And go to the index. Try to find out what circular definition is. Now, you look up under C, circular definition, and you, it will say C, definition circular. And then you go under definition circular, and it says C circular definition. In fact, he has given you the correct illustration of a circular definition. This is neither a definition as a short form nor an operational definition, but this is another type of useful definition which tells us what a circular definition is. And by the way, this is the perhaps the only exception where a definition can be, we will understand by circular definition the circular definition. But if you ask somebody where is Nagpur, and he will say, you know, 65 kilometers northeast of Wardha. Where is Wardha? 65 kilometers southwest of Nagpur. You never know where Nagpur is and Wardha is. You know the relative positions. This also is a circular definition. Okay. Now, why am I saying no to circular definition, and why did I spend 5 minutes and one slide on this? I have collected your answer books today morning, but I am going to return them to you soon. I have not, I have just browsed through, but I am sure when it came to the last question on the first page and the first question on the last page, what is heat and what is temperature. Okay, and many, many of you for these two together have provided a circular definition. I will return the answer book to you and you will find that that is true. And if you think about it, you will agree that many, many of you have done that. I don't really blame you, because many, many good books on thermodynamics, traditionally renowned books on thermodynamics, fall into the same trap, defining heat in terms of temperature, temperature in terms of heat. In fact, in 2001 or 2002, I gave a very small talk about teaching and learning in the 21st century. And I gave this illustration, but then when everybody started laughing about this, I said, this is what we learn in thermodynamics. And from, I won't tell you which book, from a book I extracted definition of temperature. It says it's degree of hotness without defining what it is, such that heat can flow only from a higher temperature to a lower temperature. Then you go to heat, because heat is one of the things used there. Oh, heat is a type of energy which can flow from a system at a higher temperature to another at a lower temperature. The same thing, golmaal. Okay, I have to straighten that out, and we will do that, because as a rule we don't want circular definition. But that doesn't mean that we are not going to have forward references. In thermodynamics, unless you are a purist and want to teach it in an absolutely academic way, so that half the students will simply run away even from mechanical engineering, if you try only from backward to forward, you can't make much progress. An illustration, sooner or later, we will talk about an ideal gas. We will say ideal gas has two characteristics. One is the equation of state is of the type PV equals RT, and second one, the thermal energy or thermal internal energy is a function only of temperature. Now, are these two linked to each other? Yes, they are. After deriving property relations, we can show that these two are consistent with each other. That means if the equation of state of a fluid is PV equals RT, its thermal internal energy should not be a function of any variable other than temperature. That means if temperature is fixed, it can't vary with pressure. Temperature is fixed, it can't vary with volume. This you have to tell the student, because, sir, why is it independent of temperature? You have to say that we will derive it when we do property relation. That's a forward link. But this doesn't lead to circular definition, because this is some information which we are going to demonstrate later, being used in advance as an illustration or as a convenience. We are not going to derive any thermodynamic principle out of the ideal gas law. Okay. So that way we do not fall into the trap of a circular definition. So now let us come to the first definition. We have said thermodynamics had something to do with energy. In particular, we are going to look at the way how energy is transferred. And in what form? The forms of or modes of transfer. The moment you talk of transfer, there is going to be a recipient, there is going to be a donor. There is going to be something from, something to. It's a transaction. It's a give and take. Consequently, we have to be very clear about what gives and what takes. And that brings us to the first definition of a system or a thermodynamic system. At this stage, we should tell our student that the word system is a very general word. You have social systems, you have systems of equations, you have economic systems, you have managerial systems, you have systems, thermodynamic systems, what not, planetary systems. Okay. The system is a very common word, and hence in thermodynamics what we define is a thermodynamic system. However, if we start using this thermodynamic system, all our thermodynamics books will be 2-3 millimeters thicker. Instead of 2 hours to write an exam, we will need 2 hours 10 minutes. So, in thermodynamics, the word or the adjective thermodynamics is often dropped. So, in this course, in this subject, when we say system, unless I say anything else, it will be assumed to be thermodynamic system. So, when I define a system, I will be defining a thermodynamic system. You tell them that, because in thermodynamics there are many, many adjectives. Even in heat transfer, you talk of emissivity. Now, by default, we say when you say emissivity, it is total hemispherical emissivity. But we know that if we don't talk of total, it is total, unless we talk something else. Similarly, unless we talk of angular, it is hemispherical, integrated over the hemisphere. Similarly, when we talk of system, it is going to be a thermodynamic system. So, if you are a purist, you should not write system, you should always write thermodynamic system. That will unnecessarily eat up ink, paper and time and our patience. So, thermodynamics, whatever I have shown there in square bracket, will be the default prefix. Now, what is a thermodynamic system? I think many of you have, one of the questions was the first question, right? What is a thermodynamic system? Well, thermodynamic system, many of you I suppose have done more or less okay. This is nothing but our reference point. It is a region of space of our interest and something that we are going to study. But that is not the complete definition. We are going to study energy transfer from that system to some other system. So, for us, defined boundaries are important. Any region of space with properly defined boundaries, of course, in which we are interested, only then we will define all those boundaries, is our thermodynamic system. Make the students understand that unless the boundaries are defined, we have not defined our thermodynamic system. So, sometimes we will say, let us consider one thermodynamic system. Let us, what are the boundaries? Okay, with these defined boundaries. At this stage, the student usually has a habit of a boundary means boundary of a polygon, boundary of a sphere, surface of a sphere. All these things are real boundaries, which we can draw, we can show, we can sometimes touch. But in thermodynamics, those boundaries can be imaginary. A good illustration is, well, this is a room. All internal surfaces are room, are the boundaries. Yes, that's a thermodynamic system. I myself as a human being, my skin, wherever it is, that's a boundary. I am a thermodynamic system. This bottle of water, I can say only the water inside, with wherever its boundaries are, that's a thermodynamic system. Then somebody will say, sir, the boundary is flexible, it is moving. You said, so what? But at any instant of time, the boundary is defined, that's good enough for us. It may change shape, it may even break into two if I pour it from one bottle to another. But at every instant of time, I know where the boundaries are. You could even have defined but unphysical boundaries. For example, assume there is nothing on top of this, but I want to study the movement of air. I say consider a rectangular parallelepiped type of a box whose bottom surface is the roof of this, the outer surface of this roof, say flat. Then extend the four sides by 3 meters and imagine a top surface. Four side extended are also imaginary. You can show it in a drawing with dotted lines, but no surface exists there. Is that a thermodynamic system? Yes, it's a thermodynamic system. We have defined the boundaries. The boundaries may be physical. I can touch it if it is safe to touch them. The boundaries may be purely defined. You can have all imaginary boundaries. For example, I can say here, consider a sphere of diameter 20 centimeters with this as the center. You don't see anything, but you can imagine that as a thermodynamic system. In solid mechanics, fluid mechanics, heat transfer, quite often to derive the governing equation, we take a small system, delta x, delta y, delta z, rectangular parallelepiped. That's imaginary boundary. Those boundaries is something we have drawn. Those don't exist in the fluid. Okay. But we derive continuity equation, momentum equation, and all equations out of it. Okay. Such illustrations you should give to the student. So one thing you should emphasize is this. And that also means that any thermodynamic system at any time will have its volume defined. We'll come to this characteristic soon again. The moment we define a thermodynamic system, whether we want it or not, its volume is defined. That is something which should be clear to the student. So it's not anything abstract. And one of the words which is used in thermodynamics in a thermodynamic way, but is used in other branches of science in an entirely different way, is the word universe. I think you would have come across determine the entropy change of the universe quite often in your exercises. That is a thermodynamic universe. The universe used by astronomers and cosmologists is the physical universe or astronomical universe. Now, is the astronomical universe a thermodynamic system? Yes or no? No. There are some yeses, some noes. No. Very emphatic no. Why?
Because consider Earth to be an accelerated.
I am not talking of Earth, I am talking of the astronomical universe. Is it defined? I say my thermodynamic system is the astronomical universe, which all these astronomers and cosmologists and Stephen Hawking have been talking about. Is it a thermodynamic system? We are unable to define what the boundaries are. Because the moment you define a boundary, the question arises, what is on this side of the boundary? What is on the other side of the boundary? They haven't yet decided whether the universe is bounded or unbounded. So where is the question of a boundary? So that means the cosmological universe or the astronomer's universe is not a thermodynamic system. We cannot consider it as, take for example, the astronomical universe as a thermodynamic system. Wrong, not possible. And because of this, remember, immediate consequence of this, all the laws that we talk about of thermodynamics are not applicable directly to the astronomical universe. So, in our thermodynamic universe, we will say the entropy of any thermodynamic universe can only increase or remain constant. It can never decrease. And generally, because all processes in real life are irreversible, the entropy of any thermodynamic universe will always be increasing during a process. You can't apply this to cosmological universe, saying the entropy of the universe is increasing, but only in thermodynamics, not in cosmology. It may be increasing, it may not be increasing, but we can't say anything about it. Okay? Make this clear, because students, those who are interested in physics, would have learnt about the cosmological universe, Big Bang theory, something, and this question is likely to come up. So our discussion on that should be that universe is not a thermodynamic universe. It's not a thermodynamic system because the boundaries cannot be defined. Okay, is that clear? That's the first emphatic point you should make.
But the surrounding is not defined in the boundaries. Actually, if we talk about the universe, can we start system and surrounding?
In thermodynamics. In thermodynamics. In cosmology, if you say universe is our system, what is the surroundings? What is the boundary? Astronomers don't yet have an answer to that. So the astronomer's universe is not our thermodynamic universe. You are right, our thermodynamic universe is system plus surrounding, so long as both together form an adiabatic system. Since there is no boundary, we don't know what is happening outside the boundary for the astronomer's universe, and hence we cannot determine whether it is adiabatic or not. So that's a stalemate, but we have to live with it. Okay, so that brought me to thermodynamic systems. So 2.3, then I have mentioned the importance of boundaries. Why are boundaries important? Because energy transfer will take place across a boundary. And at this stage, we should say the importance of boundaries. We will always be looking at one system and some other system, and we will be looking at what happens across the boundary. This is system A and a system B, and this is the boundary. And as we proceed, we will notice that everything of thermodynamics has to do with some such schema. There will be a system A, there will be a system B, something will happen across the boundaries, changing something for system A, changing something for system B, and we will relate that to what happens across the boundaries. That is why the boundary or boundaries of a system are important. Now, just now I said that look, there is a give and take, so system A undergoes a change, system B undergoes a change. So this changes, this also changes. Now the question is how and how much. So we must notice the change. And how do you notice the change? Here we formalize this idea by defining the state of a system. That's the next topic. Actually, the complete thing should be thermodynamic state of a thermodynamic system. But I have already started deleting the adjective thermodynamic. By default, it remains everywhere. Now, when it comes to the state of a system, we do the following. The state of a system is crudely, this is not a definition, is the situation the system exists. So what is the state of our mind? Well, when we are asleep, the state of our mind is cool, quiet, quiescent, no thoughts happening. That is the situation. That is the state our mind finds itself in. Just before an examination, what is the state of our mind? Thinking only thing about thermodynamics, tensed, high blood pressure, maybe high temperature. That's the situation of our mind. Now, how do we quantify? What is the operational definition? The operational definition of the state of a system is like this. We define the state of a system is defined by the following. So this is the process. Number one, make a list of all relevant characteristic of the system. You think volume is important? Write it down. You think mass is relevant? Write it down. You think pressure is relevant? Write it down. What else? Whatever. List out. Now, what is relevant and what is not relevant? It's something which thermodynamics will not tell us. That will come out of our experience. Okay. For example, if this water is our system, water inside the bottle, and maybe I am interacting it by holding it in my warm hands. It came out of a refrigerator, so it was chilled. My teeth don't agree with chilled water, so I was warming it. So called in a crude sense, heating it up. Now, when I am doing that, you agree mass of the volume, water is important. Volume of the water perhaps is important. But do you think the shape of the water, the surface area of the water is important? It may not be relevant. Okay. But suppose I am trying to make it frothy. Then naturally the surface area of the water may become important. So depending on what we are going to study and in what detail, the list of relevant characteristics may go up and down. But remember, thermodynamics does not by itself as a science tell us how many and which relevant characteristics. Okay. Now the second part of this is the state of a system will be completely defined when you have the relevant characteristic listed and quantify each characteristic. Typically by measurement. So suppose our volume is V, you say 100 cc. How did I do it? I poured it out in a measuring glass, it said 100 cc. So that's 100 cc. Pressure, well, this is not leak proof, so it's 1 atmosphere. Why? It's open, so it will be atmospheric pressure. I found out from a barometer that it is 1 atmosphere. Okay, mass. I measured the mass of this, then poured it out, measured the mass of the empty bottle. By difference, I got the mass of it. Okay, if you want temperature, use a thermometer to determine what the temperature is. So when you do these two things, we say we have defined the state of a system. Okay. So let me again take an illustration. Let us take gas in the LPG cylinder in our kitchen. Okay. You will say, look, mass of the gas is an important thing. We are paying for it. Volume may be important, but it's a solid cylinder. Let's forget its expansion, contraction. So you may cross out volume. Temperature, yes. I don't want it to be too hot. Pressure, yes. I don't want it to leak or burst. And then you may say that, look, when I got it fresh, 14.6 kg temperature, it came in a shaded van, pressure, well, I was told by the refinery that this is say 18 bar. So what we have done is we have created a list of relevant properties and then we have quantified that list, provided a value to each and every relevant property. And what we have done, we have defined the state of a system. And this is an operational definition because it provides us a procedure. It says, step 1, make a list of properties. Step 2 or step 1A, strike out whichever are irrelevant. List of characteristics, strike out irrelevant ones, so you end up with only relevant ones. And then for every relevant ones, provide a value or obtain a value by measurement, reference, whatever it is. And you can take, I took gas in a cylinder, you can take water in a this thing, you can even take water flowing through a pipe, the rate at it which flows, the, its mean velocity, these are all relevant characteristics. And when you quantify that, you are providing a state of that system. You will notice that I have jumped from 4 to 6. There is a topic in between, classification of systems, closed, open, isolated. I have not done it by inadvertence. I have done it on purpose. We will do that after say 15 or so, remind me at that time, okay, because this is a revelation that being closed or being open is not the property of a system itself, it is a property of the system while undergoing a process. So unless we talk of a process, we should not really talk of a closed and open system, okay, we will come to that. Okay, now the next thing is our microscopic and macroscopic viewpoints. Now here notice mass, temperature, pressure, volume, the properties which we listed and which we considered were the so-called macroscopic properties, because we said that we will be considering everything to be a continuum, so these macroscopic gross properties were relevant to us. But if you are talking to a physicist or a chemist, he will tend to look at this water as a collection of so many Avogadro numbers of the molecule H2O. So he always talks in terms of molecules and atoms, microscopic particles. So the next thing we do is look at the viewpoint, possible viewpoint. And the viewpoints are for description of a system. One viewpoint is microscopic, one viewpoint is macroscopic. In microscopic, we say that any system will consist of a large number n of molecules or particles or atoms or whatever. What is the order of n? 10 raised to 25, 10 raised to 26, okay. 18 grams. Even smaller quantity of this, 18 grams of water has 10 raised to 23 molecules of H2O. Each molecule, assuming that each one is simply a particle, point particle, then typical, each one will have 3 velocity components and 3 position components. So minimal 6n variables there. And if it is an H2O molecule, which is not a point molecule, orientation, which also may be changing with time. So you have a huge number of variables. Okay. So huge number of variables. But do physicists and chemists really talk about these 10 raised to 26 values? Never. What they do is they go into the realm of kinetic theory, of statistical mechanics. So you end up with statistical stuff. That means you talk about averages and variations about averages. And you end up with kinetic theory or stat mech or stat thermodynamics, whatever you call it. When it comes to statistical thing, the distinction between mechanics and thermodynamics sort of blurs. What do? When it comes to macroscopic, we consider the system to be a continuum. We also say no quantum effects. And we will say it is scale independent. In the sense that our thermodynamics is not going to be restricted only to gram mass type of systems. It will be applicable to grams, kilograms, even tons of systems. So our systems will be made up of continua. All variables will be varying continuously. There will be no quantum effects. So that gives us essentially scale independent. What is the consequence? The consequence is a few variables which can very easily be handled. In the most complicated thermodynamic problems, n will be, here n is of the order of 10 raised to 26. Here it will be of the order of 10. 10 also is too much for simple thermodynamic systems. But even if you take a very reasonably complex thermodynamic system, maybe 10, 20 interacting systems, few dozens at most. So ease of handling. But of course, since we say it is continuum, since we say it is no quantum effect, when you go to situations where these assumptions are not valid, the so-called macroscopic thermodynamics will lose its validity. When it comes to very rare flow of very rarefied gas, okay, we cannot use classical thermodynamics. We will have to modify it. Similarly, when you have very significant quantum effects, nano mechanical engineering, thermodynamics as we know it will not be applicable. We will have to modify. In this course, we are going to restrict ourselves to macroscopic thermodynamics. And because the laws are derived by generalizing our understanding of natural phenomena, this is also known as phenomenological thermodynamics. Here we will not worry about existence of a molecule. So things like entropy being related to the randomness of movement of molecules, etc., we do not have to worry about. We will derive entropy from Kelvin-Planck statement of second law and its derivations. I think I will stop here. Okay. So, break for lunch.